trying to build community support to become a stronger and eventually, hopefully, you know, get some power away from the corporations, what we call the government corporate, a partnership. They can, you know, they control the government. If we can somehow get some power amongst all the people, then we can start getting, getting our power back, and getting more say in the community. I think Douglas County is a prime example of, it's just controlled by a few, by some wealthy individuals, especially all the timber people, and we've become really, well, a lot of people have, about the Winchester Dam issue, and it's a private issue. It's private water. It's water controlled by wealthy people. So I contacted Kurt if he would do a presentation so we can enlighten more of you in Douglas County about it, and he agreed. And I'm glad you're all here. We got some brochures and information over there. If you feel inclined, we have a donation jar. We would appreciate some, you know, any donations to help pay for this room. But we're glad to have you here. He's going to have what about an hour presentation?
About that. It'll be quite interactive for folks. Okay. So feel free to speak up whenever.
Yeah, and we hope to have, you know, we'll have some questions and answer to. I think this is something we probably all want to kind of think about and maybe, you know, work together about. How can we all, you know, what can we start doing here? And I personally, one of the things I think we can do is, you know, start to change the narrative a little bit. The other day there was a post on Facebook on the Winston Wireless. It was about the Fish Enhancement Derby, and she had a picture. She was being kind of sarcastic about, you know, all the local politicians, they're all, you know, of course, they're all pushing this fish enhancement thing. And she said that, you know, there's no pictures of fish, there's no pictures of kids here. And I just made a post, a comment on the post. I said, not about the fish, not about the rivers, and not about the kids. It's about big timber and their propaganda. And I was surprised that it got like, so you got about 10 positive, you know, comments. And I think that's the little things that we can do. It's just like, when you get a chance, you know, make those kind of comments. Just say, no, this is not what the narrative really is. So I think a lot of little things that we can start doing to kind of say, you know, no, this isn't what it's about. So anyway.
So, John, is Community Rights, is that a national group?
We are part of a national group. Community Environmental Legal Defense Fund is the main national organization, and they provide support for us. And we're also part of a state group, the Oregon Community Rights Network. So we all kind of work together, and there's international groups too that kind of have the same philosophy, and some of the best results have been produced, you know, in Ecuador. They've got a lot of success going. It's not exactly part of our group, but they have been getting a lot of the same issues, you know, incorporated, you know, in their constitution. So it's a building a movement, and we just want to try to work, you know, just kind of work with as many groups as possible, and that's what we need to do. So anyway,
Thank you for the introduction, John.
Sure.
Thank you to your group and everyone for having me here tonight. My name's Kirk Blaine. I'm the Southern Oregon Regional Coordinator for Native Fish Society. I do live here in Douglas County, so I'm from here. I've been here for about 6 years now, six or seven maybe now, but wonderful place. My wife and I love it here. We love the outdoors and love the fact that we have that access here. And so that's why we're still here. I'm gonna go ahead and shut down these lights just a little bit. More. Is that good or do you want more?
More.
Good.
A little more?
Yeah. Thank you.
Cool. So like I said, thanks for having me. And I'm going to start off the presentation tonight a little bit about Native Fish Society and what my role is there, just to give you a little bit of background. Native Fish Society is guided by the best available science. And we're advocating for the protection and recovery of wild native fish and stewardship and habitats that sustain us all. We were started in 1995 by a small group of passionate anglers and advocates that got together to stand up for their home waters. Since then, it's grown immensely, and we're located throughout the Pacific Northwest. We exist to cultivate groundswell of public support necessary to revive abundant wild fish, free-flowing rivers, and thriving local communities. So similar to what John just said, it's about the groundswell of folks that we can engage to come out and stand up for the fish, the rivers, and the community, because we really believe that it's a holistic system and we all are participating in it as one. This is a picture of some sockeye salmon. Native Fish Society has a couple different structures within our organization. And one of those structures is our River Steward Program. And what it is a network of place-based river advocates that stand up for their local watershed. So currently we have 67 different river stewards safeguarding over 4,000 miles of rivers. That's 174,000 square miles of watersheds in four states. As you can see, we span everywhere from Northern California. We actually had some folks up in British Columbia for a while, so that was pretty cool. These rivers down in Northern California are like the Van Dusen, the Eel, that area. Of course, we have folks located here in Southern Oregon. Our executive director actually lives in Pistol River down in by Gold Beach. We have folks Central Oregon, Idaho, and then up into Washington. So,
is
it
Umpqua up there?
It is. So it's I believe it comes in right here, or maybe it's this one. It comes down, but this is the area. We have two river stewards up here: Rich Selman, he's a guide up on the North Umpqua River, and Brian Soule. He's actually from Ashland. We're missing one of our river stewards here tonight, and that's Bob Honey. I don't know if folks know him.
Yes.
he's our Lower South Umpqua River steward. His river cleanups are awesome. And then the other river steward, which you guys might be familiar with, is Stan Petrowski. And he lives up in Tiller area and stands up for those rivers up there. Stan's been engaged with the organization for probably well over a decade.
So when you say stands up for the river, what does that mean? Writes letters to the editor?
Yeah.
Talks to people? What?
So Stan actually works with a lot of restoration projects right now. He was monumental in the suction dredge reform for the actually statewide legislation. So it's now illegal for them to suction dredge without a permit through DSL. And up until, I think it was like 4 years ago, it wasn't. So now any suction dredger that goes out on the river, they're required to file for a permit through DSL. DSL has to grant that permit to make sure they're not on essential salmonid habitat, which basically all our watersheds. we worked really hard to get everything in there. So it really like narrowed things, the scope of things down. Funny story is Stan and I was out visiting Stan one day, and I was like, let's get out on the river. So we put his little boat on up in Tiller, and we floated to Milo. We were going away from the road, and we actually found a suction dredger. He was out there. As we all are familiar, usually carrying when they're out there, I'm pretty nervous. Stan told him what he was doing wrong. I was able to mark the spot with my GPS, contact OSP and ODFW, and the next day they were able to remove the guy from the river. So it was a huge success story, but it's just one thing that shows having those place-based advocates out there. I guess they busted about 5 or 6 suction dredgers that summer, and it happens every year. So yeah, so that's our River Steward program. The other program that we have is the Native Fish Fellowship Program, and this is a network of exceptional experts who are dedicated to the survival of native fish. These are folks that have like an expertise in a certain field that volunteer for us. Our organization is based entirely off of volunteers. We deal with certain people and pay for consulting. All these folks are volunteers. We have anything from a fish biologist to an underwater photographer to economist, Ernie Mimi. I don't know if folks know Ernie. Let's see, what else do we have? More fish biologists, a web designer, a data analyst fella from up in Seattle. So whenever we have a need or see that need, we can reach out to these folks and they will help us in their free time. So it's a pretty cool program. So we're really, our strength comes in our grassroots support and mobilizing. And we do that through the 5 H's is what we call it. Actually, the 6 H's.
Is a G.
4 H's and a G.
There's only five things H's, there.
Sorry. This slide always gets me because it's missing the fifth H. So right now, like we do it through the 4 H's plus heat is our fifth H. We added that 2 years ago based off of climate change being one of the most impactful things that we can do to help restore our fisheries. So the other 4 H's are hatcheries, hydropower, harvest, and habitat. Hatcheries are a huge impact through integration as well as competition to our wild fish. Hydropower, as we all know, blocks fish passage as well as creates barriers that are more difficult for fish to pass, and we'll talk obviously more about that today. Harvest, both commercial as well as sport harvest are things that we focus on. And lastly, habitat projects. There's a lot of large-scale habitat projects in fisheries, so the habitat as well as hydro, we usually lean on our partners to focus on, and we really focus on hatcheries and harvest. I wanted to share a couple of the campaigns that we currently have, that we had last year and that we're gonna keep going. Deschutes River we're focused on, the Klamath River dams, I've been heavily involved in that. The Shasta River in Northern California, which is a tributary to the Klamath, working with our Shasta River on permanent in-stream flows, as well as some culvert replacements. The Rogue, we've been working with our Senator Merkley, which I think some of the folks went to the town hall. We were working with them to get some funding in order to improve habitat for our partners at ODFW, as well as the Watershed Council down in the Rogue. Eel River, white salmon up in Washington, the South Umpqua, the main salmon Umpqua. We're working on bringing awareness to the issue with predation on smallmouth bass in the main stem as well as the South. We're working on a barrier at Parrot Creek. It's still in the process. We're also working in the Malala, Willamette, and then the North Umpqua. We've really been advocating for an all wild steelhead North Umpqua, which has happened, but there's a lawsuit out to adjust that. And I want to give a shout out to Ken Carlone. He's been awesome to work with, and he's been involved with that campaign with us for the last 2.5 years. So he's wonderful to work with in Umpqua Watershed. So thank you, Ken, and thank you, Umpqua Watersheds. I kind of covered all this, so
I'm going to kind of just jump straight into Winchester Dam. So I wanted to open it up to the room to sit to see kind of any of the burning questions that you might have that you hope I'm answering tonight, or what you wanted to get out of the presentation. Does anyone want to share? Go ahead.
Are the smallmouth going to move up the north of the river and take that up?
Great question. Unfortunately, they're already up there, is what our suspicions are. There's been a lot of record of folks seeing them up there. A lot of people say that it's a barrier, but there's ODFW hasn't released any record of a smallmouth moving through, but it would be interesting to know.
I can add a little to that.
Yeah, Kim lives on it.
I've seen two adults in the hole since 94 that we've been up river from Winchester there. And but Jeff Doze tells me that they catch juveniles. They've spotted juveniles. Jeff Doze is a fisheries biologist of quite a bit of renown here in this area. And he says that the ODFW has reported them from as far up as Steamboat. But what appears to be happening, Rick, is that that once they get up into the high gradient cold water, they just don't thrive.
Yeah.
And even though, I think the two adults that I saw, I suspect my neighbor dumped them in there trying to get smallmouth bass going in, because they looked very lethargic. They were full grown, looked kind of pretty lethargic.
Yeah.
And I've never seen a juvenile. I've never seen a adult. I saw them both on one day, and that's it. So I suspect it was a neighbor attempting to get a little smallmouth bass fishery going in our neighborhood. Fortunately, it's too high gradient and too cold so far. For that.
Yeah. Like Kid said, that's the main issue. They're like, if you do the Amaker flow, Amaker to Hessness in the summer, like there's not a substantial number of smallmouth bass in there at that, even in August.
Where?
From the dam down to like
River Forks.
Yeah. Does anyone else have any burning questions or any thoughts before we get started?
Well, cool. I want to know when the lawsuit's going to kick in and force it to tear it down. That's what I want to know.
Yeah.
So there's currently a lawsuit right now filed by Winchester Water Control District, Steamboaters, which I am a steamboater, so, and then Pacific Coast Federation of Fishermen's Association. So I'll hit that at the end, for sure. I just want to
try something real quick and open up presentation mode, because I have some notes I want to access.
Makes me dizzy just watching.
Don't follow me out. No, it's just going straight off, isn't it? That's okay.
Awesome. So I'm going to jump into a little bit of history. It was built in 1890. It was initially only built 4 feet high. It was raised to 16 feet tall in 1907. The main source of water and electricity to the city of Roseburg until 1923. So back in 1923, it was over on the south side. There were turbines over there. They had both water as well as power. Over the history, electricity switched sides multiple times. So the electricity kind of was brought back over. It wasn't profitable, so they got rid of it on this side. It was actually killing a ton of fish and false attraction flows. So the steamboaters worked hard against that as well. So a lot of history there. In 1945, they finally built a more permanent fish ladder, and that's when they started counting fish at Winchester Dam. Before that, when it was 4 feet tall, the fish would actually swim up the south side of the river, and then they'd make their way across that bedrock, and it was not very tall. You'll see in the next few slides over here, the fish were able to jump up and over. So there was no, obviously there's fish passage issues, but there was not a total 16-foot passage per year. It's an original timber crib. It's 130 years old. So it has, there's been patches to it, but it hasn't been totally updated. It's got a concrete seal on the top south side and a wood seal on the north near side. You can see the break in it right in the middle there. Again, this was updated years ago, and not much has changed with that aspect of it. The power turbines historically, like I said, were located on the south side. They moved back over. Again, the City of Roseburg water intake now currently is still on the south side. And when we look at this picture and the next few pictures, you can see the main channel of the river comes up the south side of the bank. So the south side would be that far side in this picture. Fish naturally migrate up that south side, up the main channel. And so they're forced to actually bump their head off the wall the whole way across. There's false attraction flows right here at the roller gates and the bell curves. See them on the far side. I'll get into that a little bit further, but it's a great place to see fish jump because they come up that main channel. They see that little bit of false attraction and they start jumping. Right here is the fish ladder. I'm sure folks have seen a lot of the hype about the fish ladder through Roseburg Tracker maybe and some of the other folks. So fish passage. This is a picture from the new cam that's live. You can actually live stream it through Uncle Fisherman's Enhancement Derby. This is a picture of a male coho going through, so an ESA listed species. I wanted to go over kind of just some of the issues that are currently there with fish passage. There's false attraction flows throughout, which we'll talk about, but even for the fish to get up that main south channel, they come to this ladder here. And there's multiple different entrances. There's this low entrance on the far side, close to that little curtain. The bubble curtain is what they call it, where it comes down and dumps in. And then they have the high entrance flows, entrance over here. I've spent a lot of time out there, and I know Jim McCarthy has with Water Watch, and we've never seen a fish go in that high flow entrance, even at high flows. So somehow the fish are making it in there. From the time they make it in there, they have to somehow navigate their way around this maze, obviously going into flows, to make it all the way up into the fish viewing room. And then this is a camera right after the fish viewing room, if you've been to the ladder. And then the fish make it up and over. So a normal fish passage, you don't have this many right-hand turns, right-angle turns, because it confuses the fish. It's really difficult for them to understand. You're coming up a river for hundreds of miles, swimming straight, and then all of a sudden you're turning every 5 feet, 10 feet, if that makes sense. So, again, this was state of the art back in 1945 when they put it in. It definitely is not now. It doesn't meet federal or state fish passage regulations.
So. Kurt?
Go ahead.
My memory is shady, but maybe you know the answer to this too, Ken. I think it was in the 80s that they were going to build a whole set of turbines on the north side, had a company that was going to do it, and they substantially remodeled the fish ladder at that time.
Yeah.
And so, then it didn't pan out, and so they never put in the turbines, but the fish ladders are still there.
Yeah, so they updated that, but they didn't update it substantially, is that kind of what your question was? But did they put a whole ladder in?
There's been a whole series of attempts to use that. Why wouldn't they build a fish ladder over on the south side where the fish are?
It's a good question. That would make sense, right?
Somebody was dyslexic.
Yeah. I don't know exactly what went into the process and why they built it there, but that is one of the solutions that we would be happier with if they really wanted to keep the dam. So we'll get into that a little bit more. But the ideal place, like you said, for a fish ladder is dirt on the south side for them to get up and over. I just want to share with folks, I know everyone problem. Or Alan, did you have a question?
My question was about lamprey and especially the impediment, the 90 degree angles.
Yeah.
That are created with fish ladder and how they impede the upmigration of lamprey.
Cool.
Was that in 93 they did that?
So I'll just share real quick. The anadromous fish that use it, there's also trout that use it as well. So there's folks, someone just walked in. But so the anadromous fish that use it, coho and lamprey are right here. Pacific lamprey and coho. Then we also have Chinook salmon, both spring Chinook, fall Chinook. We have steelhead, both winter and summer steelhead. We have light use from rainbow trout. Suckers use it, which are not native. And then every once in a while they have recorded, if you look at the non-native species that they record going through, brown trout, but they don't have smallmouth on there. It's a question that I would like. A lot of folks say that the ladder's too turbid to allow smallmouth to move up it, but we're fairly confident that there's smallmouth up there, like Ken said, we already had that conversation. So Pacific lamprey, thanks for bringing that up. They have updated the ladder for Pacific lamprey specifically more recently. And every spring they install this new fixed ladder for them to kind of suck their way up, because they use their mouth to suck through the ladder and up it's kind of a metal face that they install on the dam, and they can climb their way up and over. If you go to the dam in the spring when there's peak migration for lamprey, you can kind of see them. I've been there with Jeff Dose before, and they'll go up over the sill of the dam, like I was talking about earlier, right here, and you can see them sucking onto the sill, and then all of a sudden they'll fall off. So it's really difficult for them to get up. They have to come up and around. And this is where they install that ladder. This picture doesn't have the lamprey ladder installed, but that is one of the only adjustments that they made. I believe the Cow Creek helped fund that, as well as ODFW. Both those improvements. It wasn't from the government, which I believe. So I wanted to get into some of the main issues that we see. I went ahead and took this picture, I know it's a little grainy, but of the dam dewatered. And I wanted to talk a little bit about false attraction flows. So those are the roller gates on the far left, or far south side, our right. If you're going down river left. As you can see, the dam is very short on the far left or on the north side and very large on the right. And you'll see the taper of it in the next slide when I have the pencil drawing. We can see the fish ladder over here. But the main issues that surround the entire dam is false attraction flows. And I put this one in here. I took this actually today. You can see the water spurting out through the sides, and here is a large false attraction flow where they took a big tree and put it up top there and cabled it on top of the dam and tried to take a piece of conveyor belt and bolt it on, which isn't a very good fix, just to be clear. We have multiple videos of fish, they'll come up against this bubble curtain and jump at this false attraction flow. In years past, this stem wall was exposed. It's still exposed a little bit, but there's a piece of rebar sticking up, so you would frequently see fish jump and fall on the side of the rebar. They actually patched this whole stem wall right here, and this is already eroded away since last spring. You can see the little bit of patch right here if you look really closely. But these false attraction flows are evident throughout the entire dam. We can't see them when that full bubble curtain's coming through, but they're definitely there.
I don't know what that is.
False attraction flow?
Yeah.
So basically a hole. And so it's a hole in the dam, and you're getting flow from the upside through the middle of the dam. And what it does to a salmon or a steelhead or a migratory fish is they think it's a way to pass.
Oh, gosh.
So it's basically triggering them to jump at this false attraction flow. Like, all this water flying out right here, there's a big hole. They think that they can make it through, but as we all know, it's not likely. So they'll fall, miss. It's shown to delay the fish quite heavily. Primarily when you think about winter steelhead, if you notice a lot of guides during high water will come and fish from Amaker down to Hessness or River Forks, the fish are actually, it's our hypothesis, they're delayed big time. Because too high flows to get up over the dam, or they don't want to, so they come up, fall back, and then we fish to them.
When you say they fix it, who is they?
When they fix, they?
You said they fix this.
Fish.
The owner of the dam. So that was a good point that I didn't make out in the beginning. This is a privately owned dam. I had it in my notes, actually. It's ranked second highest privately owned dam on the Fish Passage Priority List for ODFW. The owners of the dam are the Winchester Water Control District, and they are the homeowners that live up behind the dam. That's a very good point that I should have made at the very beginning of my presentation.
If it's a water control district, isn't that board elected?
What's that?
If it's a water control district, isn't that board elected?
Yeah, yes, they have an elected board. They file with the Secretary of State.
I think there's 100 families that own properties, or 100 properties.
100 properties.
And they elect their own.
It's a special district.
It's a homeowners association is
right,
what it is.
Right.
Okay.
And so basically, I think there's more than 100. There's more than 100, but some of them have property on the lake and some of them do not. Some of them are, I don't know what their thoughts are on this. They obviously want to keep it, it seems like. We offered to pay for an engineering report. There's a coalition of 17 different groups working together to bring the rule of law to the dam. And to start off this whole presentation, after I get done with this, I was going to talk about this, but we've offered to pay for an engineering study done to help them better manage the fish ladder so it's better for fish. We offered to do an engineering inspection. Both have been declined fairly rudely, I guess you could say. They didn't want that to be done. It hasn't had a formal, they finally had a formal engineering inspection to do repairs this year, which we'll talk about. But all the repairs are on them. This is their private dam. The water right is specifically for private recreation. There's no water right for irrigation. There's no water right for power.
Drinking?
No.
Nobody can drink it?
I mean, I'm sure they have a water right, so they can store it. I don't know if it's...
Water rights are extremely specific.
Yeah, this one is for the Winchester Water Control District's water right is for private recreation. I've looked it up on Oregon Water Resources.
And so what we're looking at on the top photograph is we're looking at the lake and those people's properties on either side, right?
That correct. And that is dewatered, so or drop down. So because they're doing repairs. You see the excavator in the background? Okay. This is an old photo.
About a dozen years ago or
yeah.
2009 is the last time that I have record of when they dewatered the dam. They have plans to do it this summer, which we'll get into.
And this is important. I want people to look at the all the exposed mud and sediment, especially on the right-hand side there. Usually that's underwater. And we'll talk more about that in a little bit.
I don't understand. So a small group of private citizens own that lake?